Okay, that was brand. We're on to pipeline now. And this is the end of our first part. We have four parts to do today. This is the longest part. The next parts will be much faster. The pipeline, it was raised in the center table here, and it's a major issue as far as I'm concerned. We talked about aging clients at the top here, and I agree that each day of a client relationship is one day nearer its end. And for that reason, we need to create new life to replace the old life. Each day that goes by that we don't do that, the gap is wider that we're playing catch up with. And because a pipeline drives growth, we've got to make sure that that pipeline also is an insurance policy against client loss. Now, by a show of hands, please, could I ask who in their firms manages a pipeline of prospects on a weekly basis, for example, by a show of hands? We have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We have roughly 10. Thank you very much. We have roughly 10. So we have the majority of the room who doesn't, for whatever reason. That's not a criticism. That's simply, it doesn't happen. For all of us who build a pipeline, I would like, for those of us who don't do it, I would like to give you a methodology here. For those of us who do, I would like to try and improve on your current methodology here. When building a pipeline, especially when we do not have a lot of marketing going on that is producing appointments in our diaries, there are 7 avenues that you can walk down in order to fill a pipeline of prospects. These are the ones. The first ones are lost proposals. What I mean by lost proposals is we talked to Tom. Tom liked us enough to have a proposal from us, and something has gone wrong since. But Tom was interested enough to date us in the first place. So what happened? They were that interested in the first place, and it's gone quiet. Because they had an interest in us in the first place, this is often a good place to start. Lost proposals. I would go back up to 5 years on that to find ones that we wanted to win, but we did not. Ex-clients, I need to make a differentiation here. These are ex-clients, ones that we have lost that we would like to win back, not the ones who, on the day they left, we held a champagne party to celebrate their departure. Not them. But there is a firm in South Manchester, in the United Kingdom, who have a code for when a client leaves. It is L-O-C. I thought that stood for loss of client. I said, loss of client, right? They said, no. Lack of cuddling as reason for the loss. And they say, we didn't get close enough to them. We didn't understand their needs enough. They've gone away. That's our fault. It's not their fault. That's our fault. So lack of cuddling with LLC. So ex-clients, the ones that you were sorry to lose, the ones that you might be able to find a way back to. Avenue number 3 of 7 is ex-inquiries. This is probably the weakest avenue that you can go down. This will be when something came in from your website, something came in on the phone, some sort of phone message, and you were interested in who had called, and you tried to call them back, but they missed you. So you missed them, they called you back, they missed you, and phone tennis was played for quite some time, and ultimately, nothing ever happened. We never got as far as a meeting at all. Now, they called for some reason, or they inquired through your website for some reason. We can't assume that that reason has gone away or has been satisfied. So therefore, maybe there's still something there. Let's take a look at the call log and find out, or the email log, and find out whether we have anybody. Number 4 are our current clients. There has been research done over the last 5 years that suggests at any given time, 12% of your existing clients want something more from you than they currently buy from you. The problem being is twofold. Number 1, they don't know that you do the thing that they need. Or 2, they don't know that you do the thing that they need, so they try and get it from somewhere else. Number 5 is centers of influence. By centers of influence, I mean referral sources and more. So we will have referral sources who have been good to us over the years, and then we will also have people who are influential in our towns and cities that we should know and we should be close to, but we're not. Perhaps a less obvious example of this is the restaurant owner, the local restaurant owner, who sees all the businesses in his area or her area come through their restaurant every day and talk to them. They know who all kinds of people are. They can open all kinds of doors. But we don't necessarily get close to the restaurant owner to find out who they know or get into favor with them. So there's the restaurant owner. There is the head of the Chamber of Commerce. There is the local growth business who uses a lot of local suppliers. All kinds of centers of influence, all kinds of people who influence opinion of other people. Whom could be your clients? So let's take a look at centers of influence, not just existing referral sources, although they should be in there as well. Our 6 from 7 is the wish list. These are the dream clients, the top 50, the rolling 200, the ideal clients. Now, if we're looking there perhaps at representing Microsoft, that's unlikely to be realistic. I'm thinking about ones that are in your area. And 7th is proactive marketing. The things that we take control of, the messages that we communicate, and the appointments and opportunities that they create for us. Those are your 7 avenues that we can go down. When we do this and the business does not come in, we create these opportunities from these 7 avenues, the business does not come in, I have asked hundreds of accountants why they haven't won the work. The most common consensus reasons are they were not talking to the actual buyer. The business was not unhappy with their accountant. The business has no real needs. They struggled to close the deal. I believe that one. They struggled to handle objections. I believe that one. They were not sure how to price an engagement that was beyond compliance. I believe that one. They were too meek, or they weren't sure why they were there in the first place. That's what I hear from them. When I speak to the actual business owners, the Toms, when I speak to Toms and say, why didn't you go ahead with that firm? They give me a different picture. They give me this picture. Too many technical terms were used in the meeting that I did not understand. You lost me around about 10 minutes in. You guys might be feeling the same way about this presentation. I don't know. But too much time was spent talking about themselves. You're here to talk about me. My favorite subject is me. Talk about me, please. Not about how long you've been established and how you've got car parking on site. You know, they were late for the appointment. We've covered that already. They were underprepared for the meeting. So, can I ask, what is it you do here at Smith Elegant Shoe Manufacturer? What does the business do exactly? We sell food. You know, they don't seem to treat their own business, their own firm as a business, so how commercially aware are they? So the accountant will say, well, you need to up your sales, or you need to make sure you get your team in order. And the Tom says, and how have you done that in your firm? And the accountant goes, and they say, so how have you managed to make sure that your team are on point and the effectiveness is high? And the accountant goes, and so it's like, wait a minute, you're telling me things you don't do yourself? Why should I believe you? The partner seems to do a lot of the work I'd expect one of the staff to do, common in smaller firms. I didn't understand what they could offer that my current accountant can't. Typically, because conversations did not go beyond compliance in the first place. So it was compliance versus compliance. And therefore, we'll go with the person we know. They were too cheap. I didn't think they could do it for the price or the reverse of that. They were too expensive. We did not see the value. What you see on screen, ladies and gentlemen, is a consensus of well over a decade's worth of research. Please take that seriously, because that is what Tom is saying about us when we're not there.